Good morning. Welcome to our Sunday morning service, the first Sunday of Lent, February 21st. Know that you can see or hear our service by tuning into WTRN radio or YouTube. Several announcements. After our 9 o'clock service, you can also tune in to our Sunday school that starts at 10 a.m., and that's a Zoom meeting. So we would appreciate it if you try to do that. It's very invigorating, and there's a lot of lively discussion during our Sunday school session. If you'd like to review the newsletter, that is now posted on our website. And our website is www.juniataumc.net. Also, in the portico entrance, you can find our daily bread and the upper room. So if you'd like, call Lynn and she can meet you and provide copies to you. Let us now enter into worship. Today we are reminded of the healing and wholeness that is given to us through Jesus. I invite you to join us as we gather around Jesus with others, as his reputation becomes known from town to town. As we gather virtually or physically, we too are yearning for presence, for peace, and for help. Each of us has created a precious and holy vessel of embodied love. We have been through a harrowing time since our last Lent that has shattered our sense of wholeness in body, mind, and spirit, like a glass vessel fractured into pieces. Let us enter a Lenten season of recovery as we focus on Jesus, the healer of every ill. People open their lives to Jesus. We are drawn to the healer, opening our hearts with honesty about our lives and finding assurance that offers peace. Would you join us now in the opening hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
people open their lives to Jesus, we are drawn to the healer, opening our hearts with honesty about our lives and finding assurance that offers peace. Lent developed into a season of intense inward reflection and confession centuries after the life of Jesus. Yet, as we will see, Jesus encouraged people to open up about their lives, to speak truth, no matter how broken. This is the beginning of compassion for ourselves and others. It is the beginning of healing. The Latin origin of the word confess is to study and acknowledge. This will be a season of studying how we can be a healing presence in our community. To do this, we acknowledge we need to restore our own holy vessels. Let us pray. Creator God, we are bodies fashioned by your hand in your own image, shapes and colors of diverse and immense beauty. And yet too often we have ignored the sacred nature of our physical lives. Today we take you, God, because you hear our prayers. Help us to be like the others and to open our lives to Jesus. We are drawn to the healer. Open our hearts with honesty about our lives and finding assurance that offers peace. The holy vessels that you have fashioned are tired and suffering, ravaged by months of disputed rhythms and ailment. Our fragility has come to full view, and we are frightened. We cannot fathom the proportions of loss, and so we look away, sometimes even from our own needs. Help us, healer. Show us our strength. Forgive our inertia. Move us to move one step at a time towards greater care. In this silence, we sense and acknowledge our yearning for wholeness. Vessels, holy and wholly broken, needing the one open body and soul healer, come. As a reminder of God's insurance, I invite you to feel a warmth to begin or to arise within the core of your body. To do this, it may be helpful to close your eyes. Imagine a warm orb of deep light within you. This warm glow begins to emerge from the recesses of your inner being to fill and to flood your whole body until your skin is glowing with it, radiating outward. You are surrounded by light. Feel this warmth wrap you as a blanket of assurance. Know this, God's love and grace surround you, no matter what. You are a precious and holy vessel right now. Christ's light is a treasure given freely for you, for me, for all. Take a deep breath to let this truth fill you and breathe out with the relief of insurance. As a reminder of God's peace, I invite you to imagine the warmth that surrounds you, extending to those who may be next to you in close proximity. Imagine it extending beyond your walls to the neighborhood. the wider community, the church, and seeing it spread like the rising sun, let it expand to all the world. Let this be our peace. Amen. And if you have not already opened your eyes, I invite you now to open them. The peace of Christ is with you.
And also with you. Let us now join together for our children's time.
Hi, friends. For those of you who I haven't met yet, my name is Mark Burrows, and I'm the Director of Children's Ministries at First United Methodist Church in Fort Worth, Texas. And all my friends here call me Mr. Mark. And I feel very honored that I've been invited by your church to get to be a part of your faith community and spend some time together exploring the importance of healing, not only during this season of Lent, but during this entire new year. Now, before we get started, there's a few things you need to have on hand. The first thing is, those of you who joined me last time, make sure you have your sheet that you tore into. Now, those of you joining us for the first time, I will get you caught up in just a second. So make sure you have that, a pencil or a crayon or multiple crayons, and some clear tape. All right. Now, before we get on to that, I think we should all do something that's an incredibly important healing act, and that is breathing. And I don't just mean inhaling and exhaling, taking in oxygen and expelling carbon dioxide, but truly breathing. You know, every time we take a breath that's more than just oxygen, we are breathing in a spirit breath. We are breathing in the breath of God Almighty that is filling our lungs, healing us from the inside out. Let's all breathe in together, deeply through the nose, and sigh it out. Ah, oh, that feels good. Let's do that again. Now let's experience God's love in the world as an act of healing. And here's where you need to have that sheet that you tore in half. And for friends who are joining us for the first time, I want you to find a sheet of paper. And what I want you to do is, I want you to think about something, a way that you have been felt hurt in the last year. It's been a year with a lot of hurts, where we've heard mean things and seen mean things, and we've just had to deal with a lot of sadness of giving up activities that we love, like sports or singing in a choir, or maybe even coming together in our houses of worship. Or maybe you just feel frustrated at having to do so many things virtually. Or maybe you feel angry about things that aren't fair that have happened to you, or things that have been unfair that have happened to others. And when you think about that hurt, what I want you to do is take that sheet of paper, and I want you to wad it up. And well, we didn't make the hurt go away. It's still there in the wadded up paper. It's just messy now. So let's unwad that paper. And then what I want you to do is tear it in half right down the middle. And now you've got not one, but two small torn sheets of paper. But it didn't really make the hurt go away, did it? Well, now you're at least caught up with where we are. So let's all join in together for this next step. The next thing I want you to do is take those two sheets, smooth them as much as you possibly can. And then afterwards, I want you to take some of that clear tape, and in a few places I want you to tape it. So you tape that sheet of paper back together again, wherever it was torn. I put the tape on the same side where those words were that I scribbled. And for those of you who just tore your paper today, just pick one side and put the tape just on one side. And anytime you need to pause this video, if you have that capability to catch up, you go right ahead. I've tried to do the pause thing before, and I can't do it for very long. So now you've got that sheet of paper. It's a mess, isn't it? I mean, it's wrinkly and bumpy. It's torn down the middle. It's got tape on it. And I can still kind of see those blurry words that I wrote, those hurts. But are we stuck like this? No. Now we get to do one of the most important parts of the healing process. Turn the page. Look at that. Now, does turning the page mean that those hurts never happened? No. Those hurts happened, and they're part of our story. Is this new page perfect? No. It doesn't have to be perfect. But it's a new chance. It's a new start. And we get to create something meaningful and beautiful with what we have. And that's what we're going to do. So what I'd like you to do is take your pencil or your crayon, and on this new page, you can fill it. And you can use a whole bunch of crayons if you want to and make a beautiful picture, an inspiring picture, or you can write some inspiring, hopeful words, or you can write a whole letter that's uplifting and inspiring. And I'm going to write something right now. And once again, I'm not going to take a whole lot of time doing it. But once again, if you need to pause this and you have that capability at any point, just fill up your whole page with something that's uplifting, something lovely, something kind, something beautiful, something healing. And I wrote an uplifting word. I wrote, new friends. You're my new friends now. And you know what? I feel so lucky that through this, I get to be a part of you and your faith community. And I want you to know that you're a part of mine. Thank you for spending some time together with me. And if you want to give your beautiful thing to a friend or to a family member, or if you just want to put it up on your wall as a reminder that God's love is healing, God's power is in transforming. God doesn't throw away. God takes whatever there is, and we give it to God, and God makes something beautiful. And you have that power, that healing power that God put right inside you. Let's close by talking to God in prayer. So repeat after me. I'll use my voice, but sometimes I'll use motions that you can echo as well. Here we go. Loving God, we come to you with hearts, hands, minds, and souls in need of your healing touch. Heal us from the inside out. So that we may reach out to help heal your world. Amen. Bye, friends. See you next time.
Thank you for that inspiring message. As we continue our worship, it's now time to hear the word of scripture from Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter, verses 1 through 9. And this is what is recorded in that book. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah a second time, while he was still confined in the court of the guard. Thus says the Lord who made the earth, the Lord who formed it to establish it. The Lord is his name. Call to me, and I will answer you, and I will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. For thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the houses of the city and the houses of the kings of Judah that were torn down to make a defense against the siege ramps before the sword. The Chaldeans are coming to fight, to fill them in with dead bodies of those whom I shall strike down in my anger and my wrath. For I have hidden my face from the city because of all their wickedness. I am going to bring it recovery and healing. I will heal them and reveal to them in abundance or of prosperity and security. I will restore the fortunes of Judah and the fortunes of Israel and rebuild them as they were at first. I will cleanse them from all their guilt of their sin against me. I will forgive all the guilt of their sin and rebellion against me. And this city shall be to me a name of joy, a praise of glory before all the nations of the earth, who shall hear all the good that I can do for them. They shall fear and tremble because of all the good and all the prosperity that I provide for it. Here ends the reading from the prophet Jeremiah.
We Will you please pray with me? Gracious God, healer of our souls, healer of our nations and our world, we come to you today asking you to heal us from the inside out. We ask for spiritual healing, mental healing, physical healing, emotional healing. And Lord, as we come to you, lead us into a place of wholeness and holiness. As you touch us with your hands, bringing us into wholeness again. Lord, on this day, we also lift up to you those who are not with us. Maybe they're home ill. Maybe they're in the hospital or the nursing home or somewhere else, Lord. But we just ask that you anoint them with your healing hand. And Lord, bring them strength, bring them healing, bring them to their feet again, and lead them to praise you wherever they are. And Lord, we ask that you do the same with us, and we will praise you regardless wherever we are, because you are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. You are all things, O God, and we praise you on this day. And as we praise you, we also come to you asking that you strengthen us for the journey ahead. Be with our nation, be with our military, be with the missionaries, all of those who are traveling here and afar. Be with their families, Lord, and grant them your peace. And Lord, we pray for the church today, that in the midst of this quiet rest that we are in, lead us beyond the boundaries. Lead us to those that you desire for us to touch. And Lord, give us the courage to touch them and to walk with them, to mentor them, and to share your word with them, Lord, because your word is life, and life abundantly. So Lord, as we gather here today, we ask that you continue to instill in us, give us the desire, the thirst to want to be in a constant relationship with you through prayer. And today, Lord, we pray that prayer you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever and ever. Amen. Amen. At this time, I would like to share with us the gospel reading. If you will, please rise where you are as we hear God's word for us today. When Jesus had come down from the mountain, great crowds followed him. And there was a leper who came to him and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, if you choose, you can make me clean." He stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, "I do choose. Be made clean." And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Then Jesus said to him, "See that you say nothing to anyone, but go and show yourself to the priests and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them." That evening they brought to him many who were possessed with demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and cured all who were sick. This was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took our infirmities, and he bore our diseases. My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Come, Holy Spirit, anoint your faithful. Give us the words that give us life as your word speaks to us today. Renew us by your word. Set us free by your word. And inspire us to be your disciples as your word comes alive to us. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Today we're going to talk about what it is to be broken vessels and then allowing ourselves to be healed. Typically, the season of Lent is a time of penance, a time of being transformed and renewed by the Spirit as we receive healing from God. And as we take a look at the journey from Lent to Easter, it teaches us this journey to live the Easter life. Living as if death has no hold on us. I'm going to say that again. We are taught to live the Easter life. Living as if death has no hold on us. Because we know as followers of Jesus, death does not take hold of us because we had the victory and the resurrection from sin and to eternal life. As we are given new life from God. You see, each of us gathered here, we are a vessel. We are God's vessel, and we are filled with God's precious love. Each of us have been hurt and experienced brokenness in some way. But to move towards healing, each of us must receive what has been offered to us, and that is life and wholeness, or holiness. Not only for ourselves, but also for other people that we encounter. Because each person is a holy vessel, and because of that, we desire as God desires, wholeness for all of creation, holiness for all of God's creation. So this morning, up on the altar, you will see the formation of glass containers, and each one contains glass. Glass that has been broken and glass that has been made whole. It reminds us that we are like tumbled beach glass, each of us. It's a metaphor in which healing comes out of brokenness because God's hand is on us. We recognize the brokenness that is within us, and sometimes we don't recognize what the brokenness is, but we know that something is wrong. We lament our feelings. We give our feelings to God as we share out what is flowing from our hearts. Remnants of brokenness, pieces of our brokenness. We lay our broken world before God. Why? Because brokenness. Our broken lives are before us. But you see, with beach glass, as it lays there on the beach broken, it is often tossed away by hand at sea. And then it becomes, and usually is considered, a gem. Perhaps even a treasure gem. We are created to be whole people. We are created to be whole gems. Sons and daughters of God, treasured by God, with a shining luster that is shared in this world for God and for God's people. But when pain comes and something sacred is just thrown aside, or it finds itself lost, such as with a shipwreck, this is not the end of the story. There is healing and wholeness in communion with our God, who has gathered us as people dearly beloved at the table of love and forgiveness. This is exhibited in the gospel lesson today as we look at the gospel lesson of Matthew chapter 8, beginning with verse 1. And as we journey, I invite you to take your Bibles, not only today, I mean, they may not be here in the pews because we're worried about touching everything, but the reality is, bring your Bibles with you from home. Open up your cell phones, read God's word with us as it comes alive. And as the story of the leper comes alive today, as the leper receives that healing. The story tells us as Jesus came down from the mountain, there were great crowds following him. And there was a leper who saw Jesus and the crowds coming. Think about what it is to feel like this leper. It probably wasn't too long ago that many of us have felt left out of a group for some reason or another. Perhaps we felt like we didn't belong. And so often we feel like we're just not good enough. But today I invite us to feel compassion, empathy with a man who has leprosy. Could you imagine what it would be like to be pushed out of society, that no one would come near you or talk to you, or even you were feared and maybe pushed away? Let's think about what it must be like to suffer this terrible disease. Leprosy, they say, according to a commentary, might begin with a loss of sensation or a loss of touch within the body. The nerves in the body become affected, and then the muscles begin to waste away. The hands and the tendons in the hands begin to contract, and your hands become like claws. And then ulcers develop on your feet. And your hands, they become sore. And maybe as the disease goes on, you might even lose your fingers or your toes. And eventually, maybe your whole hand, your whole foot might fall off. And the duration of this terrible disease, it could last anywhere from 20 to 30 years. According to William Barclay, it is a kind of terrible progressive death in which a man dies by inches. Get a sense of this. Does this sound familiar to you, my friends? According to Jewish law and the customs, people had to stay away at least 6 feet from people with leprosy. If the wind was blowing toward a person with leprosy, they had to move away 150 feet. And the only thing more defiling than contact with that leper was contact with a dead body. Again, according to Barclay, in the Middle Ages, if a man became a leper, the priest took his stole and took his crucifix and brought it to that person in the church and read the burial service over the person with leprosy. Because in human understanding, when that person had leprosy, that person was already dead. And some people believe that leprosy came about because of the effects from sin. But then it becomes contagious and debilitating, and the person dies even though they may be living. Rabbis, they say, especially despise lepers. And they saw them as people under special judgment of God, deserving no pity and no mercy. In the times of Jesus, Barclay tells us that rabbis boasted about how badly they would treat the lepers. One person, one rabbi, bragged that he refused to even buy an egg on a street where he saw a leper. And another person bragged about throwing rocks at the leper upon seeing him. But you know what? The leper came to Jesus. Even though the world told him not to, the leper still came to Jesus. The leper knew that he was walking in pain. The leper knew that without Jesus, there was not hope. And the leper knew that only himself could walk towards Jesus with no help from other people. It was a decision that he needed to make on his own. The leper also knew that he had no promise that Jesus would heal him at that moment, but what he did know is that he has seen the healing and he had the hope because that healing that Jesus offered to others beforehand. And not only that, he must have felt about 2 inches in the crowd of people as they looked down upon him. But yet, this man loved God. Yet, this man desired to be back with the faith community, even though the faith community had its own sin and shortcomings. He recognized that there he could find that he was a child of God and that he would not be able to find that affirmation anywhere else. So really, as we look at the gospel lesson today, it invites us to see what Jesus can do. To see that Jesus offers us hope and healing. So therefore I ask us, if Jesus offers hope and healing to people who come to him in pain and sickness, how are we as a faith community reaching out to others who are facing the same concerns of sickness, being pushed away and shunned from society? And feeling the pain, not only physical pain, but spiritual and mental pain, because we as society tend to push them away. But yet, in spite of how this man felt. Upon his healing, he honored Jesus. He worshiped Jesus, as Jesus was the one who could take care of that sickness. He worshiped Jesus with bowing down before him on his knees, despite of his pain, despite of his sickness, despite of his drawn up hands and drawn up feet. He worshiped Jesus as the Lord of his life. He worshiped Jesus with humility. And he also respected the power that Jesus had as he depended upon him to make him clean and whole again, by saying, "Lord, if you are willing." And his only question to Jesus that day was, "Lord, if only you are willing, you can make me clean." And what happens? Jesus touches the leper, and he is cleansed and made whole again. Jesus touched him. Jesus was willing to bring him to wholeness again. There is a hope in this world. It is Jesus. There is a treasure in this world. It is Jesus. And also that precious gem that God loves and that God refines is us. There are times that we may feel that we are thrown away to society. There are days that we don't feel like we belong, just like that leper. And there are days, I can tell you, that I think, "Lord, I'm not smart enough to do this. Why do you have me here, Lord?" But you know what? When I hold this gem, this glass, God takes those rough edges that we have, and God touches them with God's hands. God touches our whole, our soul, our body, our mind, and smooths those rough edges. And before we know it, the luster is beautiful. It's shining, it's smooth, and the light is reflecting off of it into the world. So, church, I call us, as God says, "I know the plans I have for you." As he says to Jeremiah, won't you be the one who shares God's light with the world? But in order to receive this healing and wholeness, we need to be healed ourselves. We need to recognize and allow ourselves to be healed by the great healer, Jesus Christ. And there's healing in God's word, there's healing in God's touch, there's healing in prayer. So this morning, won't you open your hearts to God in prayer? We will begin with a time of silence and words from the song up on a video. Let us reflect upon those words at this time. Amen. Hear them with your soul.
In your love, make us whole. May we rest in your compassion. Calm the lost, weary soul. In the warmth of your love, may your peace fill our hearts. May we know Jesus, by your grace, you console, make us holy, make us whole.
O loving God, we recognize we are broken. We know what it is to be at least 6 foot from one another, to not be able to hug or to share our love or share our breath with one another. But you, O Lord, open our hearts and enter our brokenness. And whatever that brokenness is, Lord, you touch it with your hands and make us whole again. So today, Lord, as we come before you, we ask for forgiveness. We repent of our sin. We seek to journey with you. And we seek to be healed with you. Make us one with you, one with each other, and one in ministry to the world. And Lord, whenever we feel the brokenness, make sure that we are reminded that by your Father, by the Son, and by the Holy Spirit, we are whole with you. Thank you, Jesus, for your touch. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. Thank you, Jesus, for the hope and the joy that you bring in our lives. Thank you, Jesus, for all things. Amen and amen. So the closing song this morning is Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. It takes us back through a journey, and it's a pick-me-up song, and it seems to be ironic that we would be there after this, but let us sing these songs being reminded that we are in the everlasting arms of Jesus.
Thank you.
My friends, as we gather here today, as we receive this healing and wholeness, I want to remind you, sometimes we say that we might as well be thrown away, that we're like beach glass. But God says, oh no, I don't make things to be thrown away. I don't make any junk. You are a treasure. You are a treasure. You are a treasure, and you're a treasure, and you're a treasure. God has chosen you, and God loves you, and you are a precious gem in the eyes of God. So I encourage you that as you go forward, you be an agent of healing in the world. You be that balm of Gilead that brings healing to the broken world. To that person who's not feeling well, to that person who is rejected by society, share the light of Christ within them, as the light of Christ reflects off of each of you, a treasured gem created by God. So go, all of you, go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and share God's goodness and grace and healing with the world. Amen and amen.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe in the gentle loving arms of God. For everything there is a season, a time for meeting, a time to say goodbye. In all things God's near, always guiding your way. Everything there is a season, a time for laughter, a time for tears and pain. In all things God is near, always guiding your way. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields, and until we meet again, may you keep safe gentle, loving us.